Support for Greater Chattanooga is provided by EPB Fiber Optics and Blood Assurance.
Having a 3D printer has been an enormously freeing experience for me as a designer, as a builder. People rush out and get a 3D printer, and they do their traditional iPhone case and their bust of Yoda, and then say, now what? Here are all these other ways that I'm using a 3D printer, and here are the people that are impacted by this, and here's how I've made this person's life easier, here's how I've made this person's life better by using a 3D printer. I work at Signal Centers, and Signal Centers is an organization that seeks to help people with a disability be independent. I actually got involved in working with people with disabilities on accident. Signal Centers has a joint program with UTC Engineering, and you know, doing one of these projects as a junior and senior, and it's like, well, that was interesting, that was different, that was fun.
He was always involved in a lot of technical science and math and all those kind of things, but one of the distinctives of Ezra was he was the kid who was helping the teachers out with the computers. That was all very new at the time, and so he was helping them use that and became kind of the informal tech support. After he had kind of graduated out of the program, he would come back and help the younger kids get engaged. He's been a sort of a remarkable guy from a very young age.
A little pry bar under here and see if we can just pop the whole thing right off the glass. There we go.
You don't have to go very far before you find someone whose needs cannot be met by something off the shelf, by something commercial. My job is to try and make it or adapt it in some way so that it can be used by a person with a disability.
What's nice about the 3D printer is it's relatively cheap to print one thing. Ezra and I met at Signal Centers where we both worked. He worked in the Assistive Technology Department, and I was a special education preschool teacher. I got a student in my classroom that was adopted from China with Down syndrome, who, after talking to her mom, she shared with me Reese's Rainbow, which is how she found her daughter. So about a month after that conversation, I actually went to the Reese's Rainbow website and saw the pictures of all these kids that needed homes from parts of the world where people with disabilities are oppressed, and immediately showed Ezra and said, we need to do this.
Based on our background, we adopted two children with Down syndrome from Ukraine.
One of our children, Juliana, she was 8 months old when we got her, and she was had a heart defect, and because of that, she was left in a room by herself.
She had maybe 15 minutes of human interaction a day for changing and feeding, and that's the only time she actually saw anybody.
They were not going to fix her heart problem. They were just expecting her to die. With our other one, Elena, she also had a cleft palate, but she was in a room with about 12 other kids. It was just all one room. That's where they ate. That's where they slept.
Our second adoption was in 2013. We adopted Andrew and Katerina from Ternopil, which is in the western part of Ukraine. While we were in Ukraine for that adoption, we were actually pregnant with our first biological child, whose name is Chessa. Katie had aged out of the orphanage system, and so she was in the adult mental institution at 6 years old.
Emotionally, she was the one that was probably the most damaged, and so it took her a while to kind of fold into our family.
Andrew was in an orphanage. He had been placed there because his parents did not want a child without hands or feet.
We first met him when he was about 15 months old. When we were in the orphanage, he did not know how to sit up.
He had been kept in a stroller or in a crib his entire life. We tried giving him a toy to play with, and he just kind of looked at it, and he looked at where his hands would be and cried.
Just with a few visits, we were able to help him sit up. And I think it was after our second meeting with him, Ezra had an idea.
I built a set of prosthetics arms for Andrew while we were in Ukraine out of a wooden spoon and a pot holder and some duct tape and some string. And then he could use these to start playing with a ball or start playing with trucks. It's this great aha moment that he has. If he leans forward and uses his own arm, he can make that truck move too.
Once he realized, hey, I can do this, he really loved that and he started branching out more. After we came home, he really didn't need his makeshift prosthetic anymore because he was now sitting up much better. He was able to maintain his balance and reach with the limbs that he does have.
One of the devices that I've made for him that's undergone quite a lot of change is a spoon that fits over his arm.
I got a rib. Once he sees that there's a way of feeding himself, he, instead of wanting to use the special spoon, he wants to figure out, is there a way that he can use the same kind of spoon that other people?
He's taken the things that I've built for him and used that to start thinking about, hey, I can now do this by myself.
Andrew's come an awful lot further than any of us expected in a relatively short period of time. The ability of somebody with no hands and feet to get in the level of trouble that he can get into is incredible.
The day-to-day life we have has a lot of interesting challenges to it. Sometimes it's just understanding what our children are wanting or needing can be a challenge.
What's wrong? You need to find somewhere else to sit.
When you're doing something that puts you over your head, it really helps to have a network of support.
We have a lot of support from people at Signal Centers, helping our children in various ways. My parents have been very supportive. My wife's parents, my wife's family have been very supportive as well. We hear all the time from people who are further removed from the situation how much they've changed since we adopted them. It's things like that we lose in the day-to-day chaos of life. But, when we look back at the pictures we had and see how far they've come, that's an amazing thing to witness.
Just knowing where they've come from and where they're going and what their future holds. And in thinking about where would they have been, Juliana wouldn't have been living anymore had we not adopted her. And that's just the truth. People with disabilities are always people first.
Whether or not they have a disability is really almost irrelevant to the discussion.
It's not that odd. It doesn't have to be an odd thing when you see somebody who's got some kind of a difficulty. It's just another facet of them.
There are 147 million orphans in the world, with disabilities, without disabilities. It's a huge problem and it's a huge need.
If you're in a position where there's a need and there's nobody else to take care of this, you have to step forward and do what you can.
I enjoy helping people, and this is a good place for me to use that desire coupled with my technical background and my design skills and things like that, so that I can build these things or come up with these solutions, and it makes someone's life better.
People say, oh, you're so special. We're really not. We're really ordinary people who, saw this need and felt like that we could fill that need at that time.
The goal of assistive technology is to minimize the impact a disability might have, to make these things manageable, to make impossible things possible. But that means that person can go out and get a job. That means that person can go out and live independently. That means that these people that society deems limited in some way, can still achieve and succeed and do all these sort of different things in life.
If you enjoyed this episode and you want to see more of the series, subscribe on YouTube to be notified when new stories are available. Thanks.